Let's see what project three has in store for us. Okay, we're now getting to our first button tutorial, and this is important because it's going to allow us to start getting together the types of components that we need for our upcoming Wordle project, because as you can probably tell, all the things down here are buttons, right? So let's see how we build a button. And there are lots of different button tutorials. The first one you can see here is called button one, and we're going to create a button. Now I need to do some explaining to you as to what's happening here. This J button is what creates a button. A frame is a container. What we're doing here is I'm taking the button that was previously created and I'm putting it in the frame. And when I do this frame set visible true, I'm showing it to the user. Now, why is this necessary? What you typically do is you create a frame, you put a whole bunch of stuff in the frame. Now, while you're populating the frame, you don't want to show the frame because you don't want the user to see the frame as it's being populated. You only want to show the user the frame after you've put all the stuff in there. You should think of this as like going to see a play and they close the curtain and then they set up all the scenery behind the scenes, behind the curtain, and then they open the curtain so you can see the scene after it's already completed. So that's what's happening here. Here you can see it starts off with the curtain closed. When I create my frame, I can put all kinds of stuff in there. In this example, there's only one thing going in there, so it's not a big deal. But I could put 30 different things in the frame. And then when I do this set visible true, that's opening the curtain and letting the user see what's there. So let's run this one. This is an extremely simple example. Now, you notice you can't see the button, and this is going to happen to some of you also. There is a button on the screen. Can anyone see where it is? Yes, sir. Where is it? It's all the way up here, and it's curled up into a tiny window, and you just need to stretch it out so that you can see the button. Now, believe it or not, that's a button. It's taking up the whole frame. Later on, I'll show you how to not make it so big, but look what happens when I press the button. You see the little color change? Isn't that nice? Now, why isn't it doing anything or saying anything when I press the button? We haven't written any code yet. So I'm going to get you started by letting you copy this code. And we're going to take this and we're going to build on top of it. And we're going to make the buttons fancier. Now we're going to go absolutely crazy. Are you ready for this? Two button. Yeah. So let me show you that here. So here we're going to create two separate buttons. We're going to call them button one and button two. We create the frame as before. One new thing we're introducing now is we're setting the layout of the frame to be a grid. And I'll give you better examples soon, but right now you can just assume that as you add stuff to the grid, they go left to right. So you can see here, here's first button I'm adding, here's the second button I'm adding. So now they're going to be side by side. And then I'm going to show the grid. So let's run this one and show you what it looks like with two buttons. And once again, you can see that the frame is collapsed. I'm going to show you next on the next example how to make sure that it's not collapsed. But right now, you just manually uncollapse it. And you can see that here are the two buttons. Here's button one and here's button two. You can see here I'm creating a grid layout object and I'm using this set layout method, and I'm putting a grid layout object in there as a parameter to tell the frame that it should use that grid layout as its layout strategy. Now I'm moving on to the third button demo. And this time what I'm going to do is I'm going to explicitly decide how big to make the frame so that there's nothing hidden on the screen. I can decide if I want to make the buttons big or small. It's important for you to understand that these lengths that I'm setting, they're just the starting lengths. The user can use their mouse to drag and resize the windows. This is just the getting started size. So let's run this one. And you can see this time the windows are not hiding on you. They've been pre-selected to be of a certain size. But notice that I can override that by grabbing a corner and dragging it to make it bigger or smaller. This is the width property and this is the height property. So now the next thing I'm going to show you is we're going to make a grid of buttons, a 3x2 grid. You can see here I've created all six buttons that are going to be in the grid. I've created a frame I've set the grid layout, but this time I've given it information as to what the grid's going to look like. It's a 3x2 grid. And then when I add the buttons to the grid, they automatically take up their default positions inside the grid. Once again, I have set the size of the frame, this time a little bit larger than before, because I got more buttons to deal with. And then I show the frame. Let's see how these six buttons fill up this 3x2 grid. There you go. So the first number in the grid, which is right here, that 3, that refers to how many rows there are. And the second number in the grid, which is the 2, tells it how many columns there are. And so as I enter the buttons, they are filling in the grid, left to right, top to bottom. That's called row major order. Row major order is the same order that you read a book. So you go left to right and top to bottom. Mr. Pandali, did you have a question, sir? Yes, sir. You can rearrange the buttons in your code in dynamically by changing the contents of the grid. That's a little bit too advanced for what we do here, but it is possible to reconfigure the frame. What you want to do is you want to turn the visibility to off, reconfigure it how you want, and then set the visibility back to true again. While you're copying the code, I need to explain to you the tiny little assignment I'm going to give you to conclude today's class. Is anyone bothered by what you see on this screen here? And what I mean by that is, if I had 50 buttons, would I write 50 lines of code? What should we do here instead of writing the code like this? Here's what I want you to discuss with your partner. I want you to think about two coding constructs that this code does not currently use, that should be used, that will dramatically shrink the amount of code, especially if there were a large number of buttons. I can deal with this because there are only 6 buttons. But what if there were 50 buttons? What are the two code constructs that we learned during CSA this year that should be used here? Okay, Mr. Pandali, can you tell me one thing, sir, that this code should have used but didn't use? It should use a loop. We should use a loop here instead of doing this manually. Look at this here. See this? That doesn't make any sense, right? What's the other thing that's missing, Mr. Degouge? An array. So you should use an array in combination with a loop to make this more elegant, which, by the way, brings us to our last example, which I'm not going to show you because I want you to do this, is I want you to rewrite this using a loop and an array. Even the setting of the names you could do in a loop. You can just put I in here instead of the numbers, and then you could just append the I value to the string to get each button to have a unique name.